Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. Let me in this session highlight some of the charts and some of the paragraphs here from that book in various places so that perhaps you can refer back to the book and read some more details, inshallah. One is page 63, the map over there, that is talking about the paths that the companions, radiallahu anhum, after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had taken in the world from Mecca and Medina, east, west, south, through Africa and Asia and so forth, and all the way to today's Istanbul in Europe. This map shows you that the different companions who migrated to different parts of the world had impacted the way fiqh had developed. Yet, if you look at fiqh from the principal perspective and the common basis of every school of fiqh that developed afterwards, after that map, you will see that the principle is the same. The principle are these maqasid that we talk about, are the preservation of life and family and so forth, are justice and mercy and wisdom and balance, and the different maqasid that have to do with bridging the gap between the rich and the poor, the powerful and the less powerful, causing balance and harmony in a family setting, in a social neighborhood, etc. The higher principles of Islam are the common values that all of these companions who went in different parts of the world had carried with them. Yet, because of the personality of the companions and because of a lot that happened in the politics of the time, you'll see much more details if you read those two chapters, 3 and 4, about the history of the development of the schools of fiqh and so forth, the Imam's era, page 65, and all of these Imams that we covered in this book and their history, you will see that lots had developed and evolved in the geography of the time and the history and the politics of the time in order for the madhahib to be born and for them to take part and to become manifestations of fiqh or Islam in different ways. If you look at the chart in page 69, you will see here the 9 madhahib that I compared in this study of this book. First of all, the madhahib are not 4, they are many. And in fact, before the 4 Imams, Shafi'i wa Malik wa Ahmad wa Abu Hanifa, before those 4, there were many other Imams that were more prominent. In fact, their own teachers were much more prominent, Thawri wa al-Awza'i and so forth. But their students, and in fact, the students of the students, had served the madhab, had served the way of thinking of the Imam by writing books that are called al-usul, or the fundamental theories. So when they wrote the fundamental theories, they were trying to capture how the Imam had thought about fiqh. But the Imams themselves never founded schools, they didn't intend so, and the schools were not really different if you look at the principles. If you look at the table in page 69, you will see that the Quran and Sunnah and consensus, analogy, interests, juridical preference, etc., all of these are methods that the schools had differed over fundamentally or in some details. And actually, if you read the rest of the book, you will see that other than the Quran and Sunnah, they differed over superficial details, over things that are not principal in Islam. Really, what the Shafi'is call analogy is very similar to what the Hanafis call istihsan, and what the Malikis call maslaha, and what the Zahiris or the literalists call istishab al-asl, or the default fundamental rule. And if you look at the details of that, you will see that all of this is just a way of generating a new rule based on old rules and considering what's called al-maslaha, or the common good. They have different definitions of common good and different ways of looking at how they could generate new rules after the old rules have been set. But they are really not that different, and the categorization itself is problematic. You will see some of this actually in this chapter. Actually, a lot of this difference between the different schools of Islamic fiqh are political differences, because a certain wali or a certain prince of the time decided for the court to take a certain madhab. You see, those madhab, they manifested primarily in courts of the time. And because the courts did not have written laws as we have today, they had ummahat al-kutub min al-madhab. So they bring the mother books, or the really the primary books of the madhab, and they make this a law. So if they are Malikis, they bring al-Muwatta, they bring, if they are Shafi'is, they bring al-Umm, or if it is, you know, Imam al-Ghazali after his time, they bring his fiqh or al-Juwayni, and so forth. If they are Hanbali, they refer to Ibn Taymiyyah, or of course after Imam Ahmad and his fatawa. And so if they are Hanafis, they have a certain number of books, and al-Shaybani, and so forth. But at the end, they refer to a number of books for law, and that is why they always tried to be precise, and they dealt sometimes with hypothetical cases and so on in order to develop law. And the court itself would take a madhab, and then this madhab becomes the madhab of the country, of the people, of the time. And then they develop, and sometimes the emir would change the law, would change the court from one madhab to another, sometimes even causing disputes between the followers of the different madhabs. For example, Imam al-Ghazali, in the 12th century, the beginning of the 12th century, common era, when in Damascus, when he arrived at Damascus, and he was very popular and well-known globally and so on, the emir of the time changed the law in Damascus from the Hanafi fiqh to the Shafi'i fiqh, to his fiqh. And the Ahnaf and the Shafi'iyya, the Hanafis and the Shafi'is, battled over Damascus, over that, because the Hanafis did not agree with Imam al-Ghazali, and the Shafi'is wanted to support their Imam. And history tells us, if you read the Tabari or any of these, you will see that Damascus was burnt and looted over the fight between the Hanafis and the Shafi'is, just because the Emir changed the law from the Hanafi madhab to the Shafi'i madhab. And these disputes, if you read about the history of Ibn Taymiyyah, being a primary Hanafi, Hanbali, Asif scholar, and his debates with the Malikis of the time, Ibn Ata'illah Sikandari, the well-known Sufi of the time, the Maliki of the time, they had debates, and the Malikis were closer to the princes of Egypt of the time, and that's why they put Ibn Taymiyyah in prison when they didn't agree with his opinions, and they accused him of going against the consensus and all of that stuff. Very, very familiar language and very familiar disputes from the dawn of history until today over the schools. The schools are political divisions. They are not really divisions in the Sharia itself. They are divisions in fiqh, how to understand the Sharia to some extent, not really at the depth of fiqh. If you look at the depth, the principles are the same. Sunnah, Shia, Ibadi, Mu'tazila, I surveyed all of these, and you can read that at the depth of all of these schools, the principles are the same, but the politics were different. Today, when we look at all of the trends that we have, the Salafis and the Ikhwan and the Sufis and all of these political groups, and yes, I mean it, that the Sufis are a political group, and the Salafis and the Ikhwan and the Tahriris and different colors and shades, and the Hanafis in a neo-Hanafi way, and the neo-Mu'tazili, and the neo-Shia as well, and all of these people who manifest a certain madhab, their differences are not really in the Sharia, or even in fiqh. They are political differences. You know, the divide, you know, the fault line between the Sufis and the Ikhwan, for example, or the Sufis and the Harakis, the Islamic movement, the Islamists, if you wish, between the Sufi side and the more Islamic State kind of side, Islamic State in Hassan al-Banna sense, يعني, you will see that the fault line is the same fault line in Turkey as it is in Egypt, as it is in Saudi Arabia, but perhaps now the, you know, the movement would be a Salafi Wahhabi kind of movement versus the Sufis of Hijaz. You will find a similar fault line in India and everywhere where tendencies in Islam and the visions that people have for the Muslim society or the Muslim state make differences. And these differences take the form of the madhahib or the form of Islamic schools and Islamic tendencies and Islamic groups. And they are not really at the core. There is no difference between the Sufis and Salafis. What does it mean to be Sufi? It means that you're not Salafi. You don't pray or fast or you do jihad as the Salafis did. Of course not. Sufism is all of that too. And what does it mean to be Salafi? Is to be totally spiritual and so forth and have no Sufi side of you? Of course not. I mean, the real Salaf from the past were also Sufis, and the real Sufis from the past were also Salafis. But the politics of the time sometimes divides the madhahib into tendencies. And of course, the politicians love to divide people over dogmas and all that. But when you look at the original form of the understanding of the Sharia, of the companions of the Allah anhum, and their students and so on, you will see very, very similar understanding and very similar principles. We divided over politics rather than over anything else. If you look at chart 3-4 in page 73, I tried here to draw a chart of the companions and their students and the students of the students and so on, in order for us to see how the madhahib developed with history to become silos, for the tree, if you wish, from being very connected and to being very departmentalized into madhahib, and people learning only from their mashayikh and the mashayikh of the mashayikh, and that divided the ummah over these madhahib, despite the fact that originally everybody was together. Everybody that anybody now claimed to be references, Sunnah, Shia, Ibadis, etc., and all of the Salaf, they were learning. And these lines, as you read in the book, are drawn based on narrations of hadith and fiqh that the companions and their students narrated after each other. So all of these were students and teachers for each other. The divisions are not real in the Sharia of Islam. And the fiqhi divisions, we have to look at the politics of that today very much. Even today, when we talk about the wasatiyah, the moderation, versus the jihadis and the Sufis and all of these political groups, we have to look at how they developed and what their intents are and what the political agenda, what kind of government basically supports each of them and what they are trying to achieve on the ground. If you look at page 77 now in chapter 4, you will see that the evidences that were a matter of consensus were the Quran and Sunnah. Nobody disputed that. And the Quran is the Quran from Al-Fatiha to Al-Nas. Yes, you have different qira'at, you have different readings, and therefore different slangs and accents. They differ over a letter here or there, a waw, a min, an alif, something. But the meaning is the same. In the whole Quran from the Fatiha to An-Nas. And yes, originally the Quran had slightly more different varieties between the companions. Each of them had their own narration and their own writings on different scrolls and all of that. But from the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, the third Khalifa, when he decided to gather all of this in one mushaf that's called Al-Mushaf Al-Imam, the Imam, the leading script, they made a kind of a voting between them, a large number actually of companions. It was quite a tedious process. And they ended up with a mushaf from Al-Fatiha to An-Nas that everybody agreed on, except for some details that some companions insisted on continuing, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and so forth, and Aisha radiallahu anha. They had some differences in some of the letters and some of the words based on the original differences when the Quran was originally revealed in the language of Quraysh, the language of the tribe of the Prophet. And the Prophet referred back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying that he wants it to be in more than one accent, not just the accent of Quraysh, because the Arabs of the time had different ways of saying things and different accents. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent back the angel with some varieties. When you have different qira'at, even the qira'at that are famous today, Hafs and Warsh and Qalun and so forth and Hamza, you will see that there are some differences in the accent itself. The wow, the, you know, there is a sect or not, and all of the details that people who are specialized in that would know. But the Quran is the Quran, from Al-Fatiha to Al-Nas. And if you compare what we read today with the documents that were left from the time of the companions that are kept in different places, you know, Cairo, Istanbul, etc., Mus'haf Uthman, you will see that we have the same Mus'haf. Yes, it didn't have dots and vowel marks and so forth. So therefore, we can read in different accents and different places of the different dots. But they don't change the meaning of anything. The same Quran is the same Quran. And the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, even though the different schools differ over who is more authentic than who and who can be a trustworthy narrator and who is not, at the end, the Sunnah in every madhab is very similar. And what we have from the Prophet ﷺ as a tradition is very similar in the different madhab. And that's why fiqh is very similar and differs between the different schools. Fiqh differs in very small details. Read any book on the comparative fiqh, and you see that, you know, they have very small details, and every school is even divided within the school over the different opinions of every question of fiqh. So if you look at now chart, let's jump to chart in page 85 that talks about the validation of a hadith, because sometimes we think that a hadith is valid because the chain or the narrators are valid. And that is not the only condition. There is another major condition in which the hadith should be valid by its matn or the content. The content of the hadith has to be valid, not just the sanad or the narrators or the chain. And that is very important, because when the content is verified, according to what? According to what's mentioned here, the different other ahadith in the same event. You cannot have a hadith narrating one event and there are other ahadith that are contradictory in the same event. Well, one of them is wrong and the others are right if they are coherent with each other. I was just talking yesterday about the hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had mentioned women in hell. And there are narrations in which he said that most people in hell are women. Okay, right, that's one narration. But there is another narration in which the content is different. And it's also in Bukhari, by the way, both are in Bukhari. رأيت النار أريت النار فإذا أكثر أهلها النساء يكفرن. So another narration says, I was made to look in hellfire in his dream, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and what I saw is disbelieving women. So he is saying he looked in hell and he saw disbelieving women, versus another hadith that said most of the people who took hell as an abode are women. That is a very different hadith, and both are in Bukhari. You find that scholars are ignoring the other one and taking the first one and making the most dwellers of hell to be women, even though that contradicts with a number of other ahadith. It's a long story, I don't want to get into the details. But my point is the content. How do you judge the content? You look at the other narrations. If one of them makes sense and the other ones contradict the Quran and contradict the other ahadith, then they are wrong. Yes, they are in Bukhari, but they are wrong. I mean, the narrator made a mistake. Obviously, the Prophet ﷺ did not say both at the same time on the same day. That doesn't make any sense. He must have said either that he saw the disbelieving women in hell, and he mentioned that woman who tortured her cat until she died, and she didn't feed her, so the cat died out of hunger, and she tied her cat, etc. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished her by hell. that is a story that makes sense and compatible actually with the Quran and everything in it, versus another story in which he is telling his female companions that most of you are in hell. I mean, what is that? That doesn't make any sense on the day of Eid, etc. So when you look at the content, and this is one example, we have a large number of landmines in the world of hadith when it comes to fiqh, because there are so many hadith that people narrate that do not make any sense from a fiqh perspective, from an understanding and jurisprudence perspective, and they require a critique, even though, yes, their narrators are trustworthy, but they could make mistakes. And in this book and in other books, later books, I just published a book last week coming out from England, Awakening of England, called Reclaiming the Mosque, about women and mosque and the hadith that are narrated related to women and so on. And this has, you know, more extensive talk about how to critique the matn, the content of the hadith, given the maqasid, how to go back to the objectives of the Quran and the intents of the Quran, and justice and mercy and wisdom and so on, and critique a hadith that go against justice and mercy and so forth. As Ibn al-Qayyim puts it, every opinion that takes Sharia from being about justice to being about injustice, then it's not Sharia. From being about mercy to being about cruelty, then it's not Sharia. From being about wisdom to being about futility, then it's not Sharia, even if it's claimed to be Sharia according to an interpretation. And here Ibn al-Qayyim is giving us a very good criteria, that interpretation is not the criteria by which we judge that something is Sharia. The criteria is the higher principles, the higher maqasid, justice, wisdom, mercy. And if something goes against justice, if the Prophet ﷺ is going to tell his female companions that most of them are in hellfire, then that doesn't make any sense and goes against every verse that talked about the companions and justice too. And therefore, it is, very, now high time to go back to the original sources with a critical eye and to bring the maqasid principles and the maqasid theories and so on with us in order to be able to judge what is authentic and what is not authentic. The rest of chapter 4 is talking about a number of tools that were used for reasoning, for ijtihad, and it's very important to look at all of these, including consensus, including ijma'. If you look in page 108, this would be my final point now, page 108 about ijma', you will see consensus, that there is no consensus over the definition of consensus. So people who claim that consensus is a pillar of Islam, or if you don't approve the consensus of something, then you are kafir or disbeliever, that is nonsense, because there is no definition. You see this chart, there are 62 different definitions of consensus that I counted in my survey. And how can you say that consensus becomes a pillar of belief if there is no definition of what this means? And if Allah wants us to follow consensus, He would have, revealed a surah that's called consensus, or a verse or something, right? Or the Prophet would have talked about it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But it's just sometimes the fuqaha follow their groups and their divisions, as I mentioned, the political divisions, and try to monopolize the opinions by claiming that a certain opinion that could very well be right or wrong is a matter of consensus, and then judge everybody else based on that. So we'll stop here, and there are so many details that you can refer to in the rest of that chapter 4. وجزاكم الله خير. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.